When mentioning my favorite quotes, this one will forever maintain its place at the top. From the country Sierra Leone, I grew up in a household of four, where the aura of determination spread through the hallways and imprinted itself into our lifestyle. Our mother is a kind-hearted, well-spirited, morally driven, yet strict and tough woman. Enduring the pains of the past herself, her only objective in life was to give her children a better life than she lived, and she would accomplish that by generating an immense amount of sacrifice and prayer. It was never easy, and it never will be easy, being a single mother of three children. Three boys, three young men, who one day will make an impact on this world. Now, of course, there were times where my brothers and I maybe were defiant or challenged authority, but we never questioned our mother's ability to raise us, as we always knew that her love and values triumph over it all. My mother's beliefs were instilled in me indirectly. She didn't need to tell us about hard work. She didn't need to tell us what it took to take care of a family, because we saw it. My mother is the embodiment of hard work. Working two nursing jobs, 6 days out of the week, from 6 a.m. to 12 a.m., you can imagine the kind of toll, stress, physically and mentally, that can have on a person. Not my mother, though. She was used to it. She knew what had to be done. The rent was always due on the first. There was never a need to rest because the rent was always due on the first. You see, like I said, she was used to it. My mother was born in Freetown, Sierra Leone, the fourth child out of eight. Growing up, she was always the most level-headed out of her siblings. Her, along with her grandmother, spent mornings and nights carrying food and water and other essentials for the family through miles and miles of terrain. It was the way of life. The woman in the household worked for the man. That was the way of life back in Sierra Leone, until it wasn't anymore. You see, in short, Sierra Leone is known for its abundance of diamonds and diamond farms, and what comes with that, colonizers and rebel groups that love the idea of attaining such wealth for themselves. The wealth and prosperity that my mother and her parents had headed was stripped away from her entire family in the midst of a civil war. Colonizers and rebels against the honest civilians like my own mother. So her family was split up and they had no choice but to flee. My mother ended up in England, having nothing with her except her first child, my older brother Kevin. The only source of income was to work as a maid for a financially affluent white family. She took care of two very, very young children while the parents went about their daily business, and in return, they provided her with shelter, food, and the opportunity to gain citizenship. My mother essentially raised those two kids who weren't even hers. Unfortunately, she would have to leave the job because she was dehumanized by the family she worked for. She moved to France for a little bit before moving to California, where she would eventually end up in Mount Vernon. All while working her tail off to try and make a better life for herself. She never complained. And this is where I introduce my first lesson, which is to honor your parents, love them, and listen to them. And if you haven't already, then ask them for their story. At times, it may not feel like it, but good parents know best. And everyone in here has at least one good parent. Never forget the sacrifices made. Never forget the amount of work and time that it took to raise you. And most importantly, never forget the values they've bestowed onto you.
You don't see the future, right? And you have a good parent, your parent sees the future for you. And she always saw the future in us. She always believed in us. She was always there for us. She's the foundation of this family.
I'm really glad I have my mom with me. She's pushed me to endless limits, and I know that she will always be there for me. She may only be 5'4", but in my eyes, she is the tallest, strongest, most empowering force in my life. Only God knows where I would be without her. She's a powerhouse, and I will always carry another lesson that she taught me, which I will use as my second lesson, to value the relationships in your life, because you may never know who you will be able to count on in times of need. Whether it's for emotional support or just to have a positive influence around you, one of the most important things to attain is a loyal, trustworthy, and devoted support system. And that can come in the form of family, friends, teachers, coaches, mentors, or anyone that is simply invested in you and your future. See, me, I've had some great people throughout my life. My mother helped me realize that family was all I really had. To keep a long story short, in late January of 2017, at the beginning of the second semester of my 7th grade year, my mind, body, and soul had never felt worse. In the classroom, my participation consisted of taking naps, hoping to wake up feeling like myself again. After enduring such fatigue for over a month, concerns from my family and my teachers had eventually warranted a trip to the doctor's office. Assuming everything was fine, they took my blood and then they sent me home. And then that same night, my own mother frantically awakened me and told me that I needed to go to the hospital. And it couldn't have gotten any scarier than that. That night would be the last night I would be able to sleep in my own bed until April. I was diagnosed with idiopathic aplastic anemia, where in short, the bone marrow stops producing blood. This diagnosis was a significant turning point for me. After being constantly picked with needles and enduring such immense pain, I became hopeless. Over time, I began to heal. It became easier to cope with the draining mental and physical pain. And I attribute this to my family, especially my mom, who on most nights came to the hospital after long work days just to make sure I was sound asleep and on pace with my recovery. There were even times where she would sleep in the same bed as me, and throughout that time I had never felt so secure. It helped me put my life into perspective and realize that my mother is the source of everything. My happiness, my support, it all ties back to her. The world revolves around her children, and it always will, and it was done alone. Male figure in our household? Forget about it. My father, Alhaji Kante, was my best friend up until I was 4. I used to pray with my father to Allah on most mornings and nights and spent all my time with him. And that is really all I remember. After that, his presence was unknown and he didn't exist unless it was to ask for money. I was really young, so I didn't understand why I only had one parent in my home. Not a single phone call or card, and there was never a happy birthday from him. I never heard from him for an entire decade. It created a void in my soul that even to this day, I am reluctant to acknowledge. I often tell people that I didn't need a father growing up, but in reality, I always wish that I had one. I've always wanted to watch sports or to talk to a father figure about a girl or any problem for that matter. I always wanted to go on trips and even be taught lessons by one. I never had that. My mother was always working, so I lacked the security within myself growing up. Life didn't stop for me though. I still had to grow up, like it was required. I couldn't stay 10 years old and keep wondering why my mom is still supporting me all alone. And that's where I began to develop a hatred for him. I didn't know him really, but words couldn't describe how much of a disgust I had for him. He was the person that named me. I hated my own name for a while. The last name, Kante, I did not want it. I became out of touch with my sense of morality. I often did appalling things to those closest to me, and then just to attribute it to a lack of a male presence growing up. He wasn't a parent to me, not even in the slightest. He was only an excuse, a reason to be mad at the world. I did end up seeing him eventually. At 15, I got the opportunity to see the man who was responsible for 50% of who I am as a person. He had begged my mother to see me, and he wouldn't stop asking. He wanted to make amends. At that time, that's where he decided that he wanted to be a father. And I couldn't tell you what clicked in his brain, but it wouldn't matter either way. I got the chance to learn where I got my voice from. I got the chance to learn who influenced my height. And most importantly, I would be able to find out what an abundantly weak man looked like. I seized that opportunity. He was, in fact, a sick man when I seen him. He had this nerve disease that was unknown to family and doctors. And at the time, I couldn't ask him any questions. I didn't possess the courage to. All I could really do was put on a fake smile and sit there. Like a computer file would, my brain had just corrupted. I didn't have any thoughts, nothing to say to him. I really just wanted to leave. The idea of having and knowing a father was just too unknown to me. It was foreign, it was overwhelming, and I did not want it. And that was one of the biggest mistakes I have ever made. And this is where I introduce my final lesson. And that is the concept of forgiveness. Now, in this world, you have terrorists, you have serial killers, and then you have a man who was incapable of taking care of his children. Out of those three, one of them deserves a second chance. My father deserved that second chance from me. Irrespective of how absent he was, he wanted to make things better, and I never acknowledged him, although deep down, I wanted to. Deep down, I knew I wanted that male figure in my life that I wasn't fortunate enough to know. But I never gave him that chance when he wanted it. I never allowed myself to. And after that visit, he had constantly called wanting to speak to me. making every effort to spend time. And I never gave him that chance to. I lack that concept of forgiveness, and up until this point, it pains me. Forgiveness is the first step to peace in our world. It's what maintains friendships and keeps doors open. Don't let your ego or your pride get in the way of that, ever. No amount of pride is worth losing a friend or a family member. Never. My father passed away in November 2021, 3 years after I saw him for the first time. And since then, I never returned his calls and have never acknowledged him and haven't spoken to him since then. I left him, a sick man, alone to die by himself. And it was the biggest mistake of my life. Forgiveness is essential for us as humans, and life cannot move on without it. To forgive is to set a prisoner free, and then to only discover that the prisoner was you. The man I am today, the qualities bestowed onto me by my past experiences, is something that I am proud of. And I know my mother will be proud too. Thank you.